So I would like to introduce the last speaker of the day, Aske Stick, who is a historian and who is partly affiliated with University of Alabama as a research assistant, where he helps out with research in the National Archives here. And then he's also currently working in Esrum Cluster, I've heard, a museum, a convent museum in the north of Zealand. So, and he's going to talk about the complaint, the slave complaints of St. Croix. So welcome.
Thank you. I'm sorry to ask you, but we're going to leave the newspapers for a little while and go a little bit back in time. And I would like to start with a story. In February 1808, the Afro-Caribbean man named August was in Christiansted, and he was selling firewood at the Sunday market. After the market was over, he was returning home to his plantation, Marienhøj, and on the way home, he stopped in Madame Booth's bread shop because he wanted to buy some bread. Inside the shop, August came into a fight with two other enslaved men. And during the fight, August was hit in the eye with a stick. He was now unable to see and, of course, unable to work, and he was hospitalized. After he was released from the hospital, he wanted a compensation together with his owner of the two enslaved men that had hit August in the eye. So they showed up at the police chief in Christiansted and complained about this, they wanted this compensation. And the police chief now commenced an investigation of the fight, and the later examination of the fight revealed that August was, quote, peacefully and respected, and he had simply been at the wrong place at the wrong time. The story about August and the fight in Madame Booth's bread shop tell us that the relationship in between enslaved people and the owners is somehow more complex as one could imagine. It seems that the enslaved people identify themselves with many different social attributes and that complaining seems to be a custom. Especially in the 19th century, the whole situation around slavery as an institution was breaking down and changing, you could say. And cases like August are a clear example of this transformation. These cases are today found in the National Archives of Denmark, and they're found in the day-to-day written police records. And the case with August is a prime example of the main point of this week, where I will explore to you how enslaved Africans and Afro-Caribbeans were able to raise their voice within the context of slavery and were able to form oral complaints to the Euro-Caribbean administration. These complaints has long been seen as resistance to slavery, but I will see them and I will understand them as a reaction within this prescribed context. And then I would like to thank, of course, Danish West Indies Society and the Friends of Denmark Societies on St. Croix, St. Thomas and St. John, and of course, National Archives of Denmark. And I would also like to thank my fellow speakers for all the interesting talks we had in the US Virgin Islands, and I really hope these talks will continue. So, in order to understand the complaint of August, how it came into practice, we must understand in which context they were made and in which context the enslaved people lived in. First of all, I would emphasize that the courts and the head of police, the enslaved people primarily acted as accused of small and bigger crimes. These crimes were mostly running away, the sale of prohibited crops, stealing, staying in the streets after hours, lack of permissions, rude behavior and speech, and simply of violence. Formerly, the enslaved people had no opportunity to bring their own proceedings to court. But towards the end of the 18th century, more and more slaves began to confront the colonial administration with complaints and other issues. And complaints performed by enslaved people were actually a common practice throughout most Caribbean societies. The number of complaints rose sharply towards the abolition of slavery in 1848 in the Danish West Indies. But the beginning of the 19th century saw its big population of enslaved people, which might could indicate that this development was going on. It was few slaves who could read and write, and therefore the complaints were submitted orally to the head of police. When the head of police refused the complaint, the enslaved people were simply sent back to the plantation again. But sometimes, as we will see through this speak, the complaint was investigated further, and there was calling in more witnesses, both free and unfree people, and sometimes the outcome was for the benefit for the enslaved people. In a Danish West Indian context, the complaint was written down and now found in the so-called police records, as I told. Being placed in the police record means that the complaints, first and foremost, were noticed by the New Caribbean administration. But it's also that the enslaved people are considered into legal matters. The police records are made up of 1,000 written daily reports and descriptions of events that took place during the day. Together with all the other courts, the criminal history of the former Danish West Indies is very profound. The police records are built up according to the day, the month, and the year, often with a description of the exact time of the day. It could be morning, noon, afternoon, or night. If you look at the picture on the right, we see like a normal day in the police records. Here there are reports of enslaved people being brought to the police chief after they had run away. And there is reports of newcomers arriving to Christiansted. And there's also a story of an arrest of an enslaved man named Frank, who had illegally played his violin on the streets in Christiansted without permission of his own. And he was now imprisoned in the fort in Christiansted. Small stories like these are reported in hundreds in these police records. But sometimes further investigation and interrogation are written down. For example, there's an unlucky story and a very long interrogation that took place on the plantation lime tree, and it took place over several days. Here, the police officer was sent out to the plantation when Jack, an Afro-Caribbean man, had fallen into a well. Jack was saved from the well and explained to the police officer that he had slipped into the well while he was getting water for the production on the plantation. Later, the overseer on the plantation was interrogated. In his explanation, Jack attempted to harm himself, so he was unable to work. That's why he was found in the well. The case ended with Jack being brought to the hospital, but he was arrested soon after. You may ask, why are these reports so comprehensive and conducted with such a great detail? The answer is very simple, because within the legal system in the Danish West Indies, writing was a key element to how the whole system functioned. Here, a statement or an event written down in a report could be used in a trial or in a court, in a different court in the system, as the system existed of several courts in relation to each other. So there was a direct link between these small stories with Jack or with Frank, and how the practical proceeding of possible juridical decision took place. So the legal system transformed continuously following the development of slavery as an institution, both here in the former Danish West Indies and in other Caribbean slave societies. As a result, the enslaved population became more intertwined with the legal system, and the colonial administration drew attention to how the slaves were treated, and to a great extent examined their cases and conflicts. On the other hand, the enslaved people also saw advances in involving colonial administration in the conflicts. And this is where the complaints become interesting, as the practice of complaints performed by enslaved people are an apparent illustration of this intercultural meeting between the different people in the former Danish West Indies, but also the transformation of the system that was breaking down. So, as we know, most of the complaints were performed to the head of police chief in each jurisdiction in the Danish West Indies. There were two on St. Croix, one on St. Thomas and one on St. John. And I should say here that many of the complaints may have been handled directly on the plantation and never came into these police records. And looking at the legal system, the police chief was the lowest one of all these practices in the system. And we must assume that it was here most of the enslaved people confronted the colonial administration for the first time. As seen on the picture here on the right, you see that enslaved people were a very common sight in the cities here in this period. The complaint was performed by speech to the police chief. Sometimes the complaints were even translated by an interpreter if the language spoken by the complainant was not identified by the administration. And this was also applicable for certain African languages. As for example in 1805, where the enslaved woman Carolina spoke a language not known by the police chief. He then obtained several enslaved people at the fort and presented them to the African language. And finally, after many attempts, he was able to find a person capable of translating this language into African language. Another important aspect of the police chief's court was that the enslaved people had the opportunity to come on their own initiative. They did not need to be called in or something like that, but they could simply meet with the police chief. Of course, this is said with an awareness of the whole situation of slavery, and that the enslaved people in many cases left the plantation with knowing that the absent could give them further punishment. Nevertheless, many complaints was performed even together with relatives or children, as this could might affect their complaint in a positive direction. Complaints was performed individually or in groups. So for example, there's one case where on the first day of January in 1800, where 34 enslaved people, both men and women, all of the names are listed in the police record, showed up at the police chief. They complained altogether about neither having received a Christmas nor a New Year's gift by their owner. This gift sharing was normally prescribed in slave societies where the owner gave the enslaved people presents of various kinds in these holiday season. But from this case with the 34 enslaved people, all slaves were imprisoned in the fort except an old man and two women with small children. As you see here, it's not always that the enslaved people got a positive outcome of complaining. And most of the cases in the police records ends up like this. But just the possibility of complaining, even though the slaves did not have any legal rights as such, that could affect the judgment of the judge, they disrupted slavery as an institution constantly. One of the major features of the legal system in the Danish West Indies were, unlike other Caribbean slave societies, that the Danish West Indian one did not have an actual slave court that was designed to deal with slave crime. This means that it was the same judges who tried the free people and the unfree people, and it was also the same place that the free people and the unfree people could report in their daily problems. If we look at the complaints from a perspective of today, the complaints tell us a story about the everyday life on the plantation and the condition of slavery from the perspective of the enslaved. These complaints have mostly been perceived as a tool to address this injustice or resistance to slavery. However, the complaints are not only evidence of this as a resistance to slavery, as they also embody how the enslaved population interpreted the complex social space of Caribbean slavery and show how enslaved people used these complaints to raise the self-identification towards different social ideals within the cultural context of slavery. Now I think I will come up with an example so you understand what I mean. This is an example of a cougar named Crystal who lived on the plantation Peter's Rest. He came to the police chief in 1807 and complained about being set to work in the sugarcane field, despite being a cougar. Being a cougar meant that he was a skilled laborer, or he was like a craftsman, and he had like a profession other than working in the field. And he explains to the police chief, and I'm quoting, "I ran away because I find the work in the sugarcane field very difficult, and I see the work in the field as shameful." Yes, he ran away and he broke the slave legislation, but in his complaint he emphasized a strong self-identification as a cougar, and he drew attention to the difference between him as a craftsman and to the enslaved people in the field. And there's many others of these complaints where these craftsmen come to the police chief and complain, and some of them even say that the work in the field is not suitable or it's very difficult for the craftsmen to do. And even in one case, an enslaved man, he tried to commit suicide when he was imprisoned, which tells us that the condition and the context that the enslaved people found themselves in were in a desperate situation, and the status of the profession was very important for them. And we can also get a tangible side of these complaints and see how difficult it was by looking at one case of a man named Frederick. In January in 1826, Frederick, an enslaved man, had been arrested for having organized a dance on the plantation cotton without the permission of the overseer of the plantation. He was therefore examined by the police chief in Christiansted. Frederick was sentenced a very hard punishment of 75 strokes, and I'm quoting, by the whip outside the fort in Christiansted. And he was hereafter sent back to the plantation by the police chief. If you see here, this arrow shows Christiansted. The case was then completed, but 2 days later, Felix showed up again in Christiansted and confronted the police chief with a complaint. He was now having a very heavy iron chain attached to a heavy block to him, and he explained that after he had left the police chief 2 days ago, he was unable to walk the distance back to his home plantation named Cotton due to the heavy punishment in Christiansted. He then decided to have an overnight stay at the plantation Oryx Group, where he had some relatives. And this arrow shows the plantation Oryx Group. Because of his stay, and he didn't show up at the work next day at Cotton, his home plantation, he was when he arrived back after overnight stay, he was punished again by the manager on the plantation. and he was even put in the dungeon during the night. And we see here his plantation closet. As Frederick did not find the double punishment for, fair, and he was able to break out of the dungeon during the night, and he has been walking all night back to Christiansted to complain about this extra punishment. Mm-hmm. So see, these travels in 4 days is quite a distance if you imagine in which situation and condition Frederick was in. There's two interesting parts of this complaint. First, that the plantation was not separated or isolated. You see that Frederick had communicated with the enslaved people on other plantations. And second, that there existed a strong perception of justice, of punishment among the enslaved people. And that this perception means so much that Frederick really took up the challenge of confronting and complaining about the incidents that took place on the plantation. They wanted to report bad treatment to the colonial administration. And to end this case, the police chief then started an examination of the fairness of this second punishment. The first one was okay, but the second one needed an examination, and the overseer was called to Christiansted and interrogated. And during this interrogation, he was giving a warning about the treatment to Frederick, and not only to Frederick, but also to all the other enslaved people on the plantation. Most of these complaints are about the punishment, about food allowance, or about forcing enslaved people to work when they were sick. As said before, most of the complaints were rejected by the police chief, or even giving further punishment for just complaining. Although some complaints contravened the colonial administration viewpoint of the slaves, and these stories indicate a legal strategy where the enslaved people stepped outside the predefined identification that was used by the administration and used them for their own benefits. One example of this contravention is found in a mother's description of her son. So the mother had left the plantation and walked all the way to Christiansted to complain on behalf of her son. In her explanation, she described her son with many different attributes. So he was described as a very good Christian, and how precise he was with his work as a manager of the work gang in the field, and also how academic he was. And the police chief started an examination on the overseer on the plantation, because in the description of the overseer from the mother, I know this is kind of complex to follow, but the mother described the overseer with the exact opposite attributes than her son. So the son was put in good light and the overseer was put in a bad light. And that means that the son actually kept the status as the manager of the work gang on the plantation. As already mentioned, the difference between the craftsmen and the enslaved people working in the field was a very common distinction and a reason for complaint. Another self-identification found in the complaints were an identification towards familiar deals. Once the abolition of the slave trade came into effect in 1803, family reproduction and health among the enslaved became increasingly important for the colonial administration. This is also reflected in the slaves, where abused family and children were brought up as objections. One such case was, for example, an enslaved woman named Charlotte who complained about having too little food for a child. And now there's another case about a man named Barn who complained to the police chief about being separated from his wife by his owner. And both of these cases were met positively by the police chief, and they both got a letter with them home from the governor to confront their bonus with the judge decision. Yes, and if we return to this question of resistance, yes, these complaints can be interpreted as resistance to slavery, and I don't see it as incorrect, but I can see them in a much wider perspective, where you can see them maybe as an opportunity to raise a voice, and they can be considered as an attempt to renegotiate their legal opportunities and engage in an actual interaction with the colonial administration, not longer as passive subjects, but in an interplay, in an active interplay. Yes, if we, for example, take a look at a case of two women named Sally and Charlotte, they complained to the police chief that they haven't received their weekly allowance by the overseer. And to cite the two women's complaints, I will now read out of the case, I would say. Most of the Negroes on the plantation had run away into the bushes, as they also tried to convince us to do, the two women. But we headed directly to town to complain. The two women did not only went to the police chief first, but they actually confronted the governor first. So they first went to his office and then went to the police chief. To exemplify, the two women had three opportunities to act, to do nothing, or to run away with the other slaves, or use the opportunity of complaining. And there's no doubt that they both thought that they would get the best outcome of complaining, and that the two women had a certain wish to emphasize that they did not run away with the other slaves, but they went to town to complain. Okay, so if we rewind to the first case about August, if we can remember that, initially, it's quite contrary to our view of a slave society in the Danish West Indies, that the enslaved people had the opportunity to complain. And in fact, it's quite contrary to our imagine of what slavery is, that you have no freedom and no rights. So, these complaints are very important. And why are they important? I think, of course, they tell us that the enslaved people were not satisfied with slavery or the condition of slavery. And I think this is rather obvious, and I think we all here can agree that this is a basic fact with or without evidence of the complaints. And it's also important to note that the majority of the complaints were rejected or taken care of at the plantation. Nonetheless, assessing these complaints located the enslaved population in the Danish West Indies into a bigger international perspective of enslaved voices. These voices of complaints tried to step outside the predefined slave society and took up the challenge to confront the colonial administration. And I see these complaints as interesting because it tells us that they had this opportunity, it tells us that they had this opportunity to interact with the colonial administration and act within this legal framework and also act on their own initiative. And secondly, the police records also tell us that there existed this clear self-identification among the enslaved people that did not correspond with the Eurocaribbean identification. This is most profound with the skilled labor or the craftsman slaves. And all this, in the end, tells us that slavery as an institution was developing. You might say it was breaking down. And comparing these complaints with this wide perspective and with events that took place in this period, you really see that slavery as an institution was dynamic and it was changing throughout the years. It was not static and unadaptable to developments and external influences. And I think in the end here, the most important thing about these complaints is that they are directly affiliated with the development of slavery as an institution in the Danish West Indies, in the former Danish West Indies. And they are clear evidence that the enslaved people confronted the colonial administration with slavery from their perspective. Thank you.
Thank you so much. Any questions? Comments? I have one. Okay, so obviously I was very intrigued by the woman, Carolina, who complained in an African language, obviously because I've encountered so many sources that talk about how African languages was used. But what I was wondering is if you had made any thoughts about if there are, can you trace any differences in what it is that people complain about? Because of course, if you are a person who has grown up within the institution of slavery and who was born in St. Croix and who has and if you have your whole family network there, your life circumstances are so different than if you, as I suppose that she's one of the last people coming in, because if she hasn't even learned much English at this time, so there must be some differences. She must have another life condition or than people who has grown up.
Yeah, so the case with Carolina, she was actually not complaining directly, just was, she broke the law and she was, she went to the police chief, and then they needed to translate the language. But actually,
what did she do?
I can't remember at the moment, but actually I thought about you when I was reading this case, and it was, and the interesting thing about this one was that it was a little boy who could translate the language. And back to the question was that what you see is that, for example, these complaints about children that they don't have enough food, you see them in the beginning, there's maybe, maybe one each month, but towards the end, like in the middle of the 19th century, you see there's many complaints about this. So you see that kind of the word spreads that the enslaved people can complain of and use these objections in the complaint. So you see this transformation that kind of spread throughout the period.
But it could also be that conditions were getting harsher. I don't know.
That could also be, yeah.
Nicholas might know. I don't know.
Thank you. Well, let us clear up Caroline, for she was put ashore from a slaving ship on Sandy Point and ran away from there and was taken up by the police as probably Maroon. She wasn't. She was just, she had run away from the other slaves that were exercising on the shore of Sandy Point sometime in 1805. And then that's probably why she was brought directly across the Atlantic from Africa and didn't speak a word of Creole or English or any on St. Croix understandable language.
Apart from the boy
who might have learned it from his mother, who came 20 years earlier. We don't know. It's not mentioned in the case anyway. I think that the slave complaints that are recorded from sometime in the 1780s up until the end of slavery, and well, slavery ends, the complaints keeps on, but takes, of course, on another form. And they are just an illustration of that, something an old colleague of mine said when he was going on away for his pension, that history is usually more complicated than we think at first hand. And
the thing is that, of course, the complaints of slaves against to the authorities, to the colonial authorities, that is never a complaint that is directed at the authorities. It's always directed at their owners, masters, overseers, managers, drivers, whoever is in authority. And from that point, you might see it as some kind of resistance. In other connections, you might see it as some sort of asserting a right that is that you might call the common law of master-slave relations. That there's a limit to whatever the master or the manager or the driver might do, and there are some rights that you cannot sort of take away from the enslaved person without making sure that he or she will complain. And those cases are full of that kind of assertion of rights. When it comes to the more rare instances where you have whole gangs marching out from the plantation and going to town and complaining, you have a sort of something that is probably not, that you can interpret as anything other than resistance, because they are simply saying, now we don't want to work no more for that man, give us another overseer, driver, whatever, and we might consider going back. And of course the authorities has to take those instances very seriously, because if you you can stand a certain amount of conflict with those few policemen that you have in the towns and the militia and things like that, but if it runs out of hand, you have to sort of let the steam out of the kettle at some point and show the people that you might in fact try to complain before you revolt. Because the revolt is from 1791 precisely, and to the end of slavery, the sort of, nightmare of the slave owners, the colonial authorities, and the rest of the authorities there, whose aim is not, surprisingly not, to oppress the enslaved population, but to make money and sugar.
Yeah, but I could comment, like, I agree that it is resistance, but I would also like to see them, not all of the complaints. There's many complaints that I have come across, and they are kind of, if you see them as resistance. But for example, this with the 34 enslaved people marching to town complaining. Actually, when the judge is making his decision, all of those slaves pointed, it's written down, pointed at one slave as, that's him, he was behind the complaint, we don't have anything to do with it. So yeah, but I will see these complaints, if you only see them as resistance, that's correct, but they are a little bit more complex than just resistance, so they can also tell us a lot of stuff about the everyday life of the enslaved people. You know, because sometimes more come out of the complaints. For example, these with the craftsmen, that they did not like the people working in the field. So I think they are, yeah, they're a very good source to understand the everyday life. So.
You don't want me to ask more questions. So. Come forth.
Did the women ever complain about rape?
Yeah, that's a very good question, and I haven't come across it in the police records. But I know there have been these cases, but it would be probably be in the some of the courts above the police records, but. As I know, I only looked through in Christiansted, so it could be more in maybe St. Thomas' in friendship, but I'm not sure. Maybe some other people here in the group might have came across any great cases.
I think that Gudmar Simonsen has found plenty. And
I remember her coming to St. Foy and giving us a paper on that topic.
Yeah.
I don't remember right off where the sources were that she got it from.
I think it's the court cases, but at least I remember one case where this woman, Anna Katrina, actually complained about her owner, De Breton, the Baron De Breton in St. Croix, and talked about how he had wanted to have sexual intercourse with her, and she had resisted, and how his wife actually sort of tried to make her just do it, because, I mean, whatever. So I think there are plenty of these cases, but maybe they are more in the court trials and
exactly.
So on.
And
yeah.
We also have to remember that all these documents has to be sent back to, they have to be checked, so, and it was illegal to have these, to have intercourse with these women, so actually breaking the law. So it could also be that the police officer didn't write them down.
But also there is a thing that maybe that's one of the subjects that it was quite difficult for the women to actually complain about, because they were in a very fragile position. So if they started making these complaints, they maybe would, because they knew that maybe they wouldn't be heard, they would be more fragile afterwards. So I think it's a case that really points also to that it might, you have a right to your food, but do you have your right to your body? That's a really good question. But I think we really need Gunnar to talk about this, actually, because that's her field. So, unfortunately, she had to take care of her child today. So, okay, any more questions? Yes?
This is very interesting. Also, follow up with your comments on the first line. How common was the knowledge about the rules here among the slaves and among the slave owners? So, and was it so that the bad slave owners really was treating them so badly that the police chief had a common interest among the other slave owners to rules, to a certain level at least, some rules, and was these rules known? So how was that? You didn't really touch upon this.
No. So if I understand you, do the slaves know the
slaves as well as the slave owners? Was there common knowledge about what was the rule and how legal was this rule? Was there common knowledge about how badly is accepted? We know, just got about the raped women. This is accepted, of course, at that time. But how about the other guys? How badly could you treat them? How was that the common knowledge? Does the police chief, and was his own ethics rules that he was using, or how was that different from St. Croix and St. Thomas and so on? Has there any knowledge about that?
Okay, so if we look at it, it doesn't seem that at the police chief, and of course it was different, other courts it was different, but at the police chief, it was very informal, as you could say, and the police chief didn't really follow the slave legislation strictly. So there are, some of the cases are, his decision are differently, even though it's the same thing they complain about. But also evidence that, for example, there's one case where a young enslaved woman complained to the head of the chief because her owner tried to stop her from going to the to church on Sunday to this confirmation parent because she was in this age. And it's written down in the police report that this and the police chief decides that the owner should let the young woman to go to church, and he write down that this should be applicable for all similar cases in the future. So you see that it's very complex, but it's also why this archival sources are so interesting, because they are not so strict as some of the other courts. They're very informal. And you, I must assume that the enslaved people were able to have a little bit of knowledge about the slave legislation, or either they talked together about this. As I told before, you see this increase of different objections in the complaints over the years. So there must be some kind of communication among the enslaved people about the slave legislation.
And also, I think, just to add a comment to that, what Paul talked about, that there's the regulations, and then there is sort of the common law ideas of what is appropriate and what is not appropriate. So there was always ideas of how far could you go. And if you hit that wall as a plantation owner, then there are just things that are not right, like with the Christmas presents.
Yeah.
I mean, the Christmas is the like it has been in European peasant societies. Also, it's the time of the year where the steam is let out of all the complication of a society where everything is extremely unequal. That you have your parties, and that's where the owner sort of goes in and makes amends in some ways. So when, if you don't actually do that, what is expected of you, then you have trespassed that line of how you should behave as an appropriate sort of person on the top of society. Is there one last question, a short one? And then we have to wrap up.
A short comment on your question. The Governor General's instructions of 1773, he is especially instructed to see that slaves are not, that they get enough provisions to survive. But those articles of his instructions are not to be made public in St. Croix, for the reason that the slaves should not have too close a knowledge of their rights.
So that was kind of an interesting closing remark. So I think we should say thank you so much, Aske, for your presentation.